Good afternoon. I have been allotted only 7.5 minutes, so I'll be a little bit fast through my slides. Today's topic of discussion is for regional anesthesia for hip surgeries, whether to give epidural or the lumbar plexus. I'll be talking pro epidurals. Epidural is a time-tested, widely used technique with or without opiates and can be used from cervical region to the lumbar region as a sole anesthetic and for post-operative management. A technique is always acceptable if it is easy to perform, less time-consuming, has many advantages, less side effects, and it should be easily reproducible. And I think epidural fulfills all these requirements. Now, we'll start right from the anatomy. Does the technique supplies all the required dermatomes, myotomes, osteotomes of the hip joint? The answer remains yes for epidurals, but for lumbar plexus, it does need the help of sacral plexus. Now, this is the lumbar plexus supplying mainly the anterior side of the thigh or the hip joint, while the posterior side is supplied not only by the sciatic nerve, but also by its collateral branches. So, this is the posterior aspect, which is supplied by the collateral branches and the cutaneous branches of the sacral plexus, the coronal nerves. Now, this region, the superior, the gluteus maximus, medius minimus, are again all supplied by the sacral plexus and the sciatic nerve. Not only these structures, but the hip joint itself is supplied by the femoral, sciatic and the obturator nerve. The message is that it is not only supplied by the femoral nerve, but there is a sciatic component. Now, the common incisions on the gluteal region are at the site of innervation of the sacral plexus. Then a region of L1 distribution, even if we give a lumbar plexus block, this is all the time spared, so we should be aware of this. Then at the time of positioning at the sacral nerve roots, in these positions there is perineal sparing, which is supplied again by the sacral plexus and not by the lumbar plexus. Now, the technical consideration. In epidural anesthesia, spinals and epidurals are the part of our educational curriculum. We are masters in performing them, so they can be easily and quickly performed with perfection. In this, both limbs are anesthetized. But for lumbar plexus, they are deeply situated, not so routinely performed, so consume little bit more time, and the non-anesthetized limb, which can move during the operation, can be disturbing. It can be performed in the epidurals can be performed in any position without special instrumentation, while for lumbar plexus block, special positions like lateral decubitus, a fractured limb on the upper side, stimulation of an already fractured painful limb, and special instrumentation like PNS, ultrasound, which is costly. What about the clinical efficacy? Epidural anesthesia can be easily used as a sole anesthetic, but psoas compartment block has a limitation due to its anatomical consideration, which you have already seen. According to this study, for the lumbar plexus block, there should be supplementation of opioids and sedatives in 30% of the patient who undergo hip fractures with additional sacral plexus block. Here is an interesting study in which Buckenmayer et al. Concluded that the lumbar plexus block with a perineal catheter and a sciatic nerve block with a perioperative sedation is an effective alternative to GA, but the concentration of propofol and fentanyl provided by the author resembles GA instead of conscious sedation. Turker et al. described that there is no significant difference between the analgesic potency between the two. I am working in orthopedic hospital from last 16 years, and to my experience, when I give this block, a combined psoas compartment and sciatic block, the relaxation is very poor. Epidural is a time-tested technique. According to Admir Hadzik, the conversion ratio of psoas compartment to GA and epidurals is about 40%. Now, I'll see some of the benefits of the epidural in the perioperative period apart from anesthesia. It is a meta-analysis carried out and has a conclusion that this technique does not appear to adversely affect the cardiac, renal and the cerebral functions. The intraoperative blood loss is markedly reduced, the perioperative transfusion required is less, rates of deep vein thrombosis is also less. The hypotensive epidural anesthesia preserves the coagulation system in a well manner. In spite of similar arterial blood pressures kept in two groups with total intravenous anesthesia and one with hypotensive epidural anesthesia, the intraoperative blood loss significantly low in patients undergoing hypotensive epidural anesthesia. The incidence of thromboembolism is very low. The hypotensive epidural anesthesia during the surgeries prevents hyperglycemia and inhibits protein catabolism. Epidural anesthesia reduces the neuroendocrine stress response. Epidurals have been blamed for the need for urinary catheterization, but here is a study which tells that the addition of opioids to the epidurals has this function. The epidural anesthesia can be continued in the postoperative period for their postoperative pain relief. We'll see about the undesirable side effects. For a soft compartment block, the epidural spared, which is unexpected in 30% of the patients, they can lead to mild. They can lead to total spinal anesthesia. They does lead to hypotension, but is less. Plexopathies, neuropathies, systemic toxicity is more common due to the vascularity of the source. Intraperitoneal injections are common. Retroperitoneal hematomas and renal hematomas are very common. These are the references for these. The incidence of bilateral anesthesia with source compartment is very high than was thought. According to Arroy et al., who carried out a study, and they found out that there were 5 complications out of 394 source compartment blocks as compared to 10,309 femoral blocks where the complication rate was none. In the complication of epidural anesthesia, only we have to worry about the epidural hematoma, but the incidence is very low as 1 in 1,50,000. My last question is the source compartment block is the technique of choice in patients on anticoagulants as opposed to the epidurals? The answer remains no, because the American Society of Regional Anesthesia, that is ASRA, recommended that guidelines for anticoagulant and neuroaxial blocks be applied for deep peripheral nerve blocks like source compartment, include the placement and removal of the peripheral catheters. In conclusion, it has all the epidural has all the advantages compared to the source compartment. Thank you.
This is a